Hi, Teresa.
Hi, Laura.
Was wondering, could we start? Can you just tell us a little bit about yourself?
My name is Teresa Pascual, and I come from the Pueblo of Acoma, which is about 70 miles west, roughly, west of Albuquerque. And so I live and reside here in Acoma Pueblo. And I served as the former historic preservation officer for the Pueblo for a number of years, and currently work as a consultant to a number of Pueblos working on different cultural projects. So that is who I am.
So, landscape, tradition, culture, how are all of these things interconnected for you, Teresa?
Well, I think one of the earliest memories that I have of the significance of naming someone or some place really became apparent to me when I as a child received my own name, which was a name in Acoma that was connected to my father's grandmother. And so it was as if there was this unseen magical bond that will forever connect me to her, even now that she has long passed, that still ties me to her name, the things that she has done in her lifetime, and this obligation, in many ways to uphold those things or continue those things that she did in her lifetime. And so I became aware at a young age that this connection to other people and other places carries on throughout our livelihood, and that there are people that sometimes may carry these place names as their traditional names, as who they were named as a baby, as a child. And then as I moved into my work with both in archaeology and both in working in historic preservation, you come to realize that this landscape also has this other layer of names that were not given by us, by the indigenous people of these lands, that they were given as a sense of ownership, as a sense of in practice of discovery, of claiming place. But that was not our tradition. Our tradition lies in connecting those values, the things that we see, our core values of who we are that are associated with place, that are associated with an individual, and then transferring our hopes, our prayers for that person or that place by giving that same name. And so as our people moved on this landscape throughout time, then it also became important that our people, as they move through their migrations across the Southwest, continued to not only remain connected to place, but also keep with them those values of place, those gifts of place, that creator imbued with those locations, to take those with us as part of our collective memory and carry those names forward with us as we settled into, and for us here at Acoma, settled into what is now the Acoma Valley. And so we have names for many locations that surround or make up our Acoma cultural landscape. And they aren't confined to the boundaries of what our reservation is currently. They extend throughout New Mexico, throughout the Southwest, throughout the great Four Corners area, and even beyond, because our people a long time ago traveled this landscape. And so when those names are remembered, when they're said, or when individuals carry those names, it is not from a perspective of ownership or of a position of claiming something. It is out of reverence. It is out of respect. It is to remember those things, those values, those guides that are associated with place that we as Pueblo people carry forward into our present day life. And so this connection is layered because of time, but it's also complex because it connects us not just to the physical landscape that we have that surrounds us, but to everything that is associated within that landscape. And so it makes a different trajectory, I suppose, for what came later on as different people came into this landscape and brought a different perspective and a different value into this area and named places that were not of our understanding, but named places in order to claim them and to own them. And so two different trajectories, two different perspectives, and it adds to the complexity of place names that we have here.
Right. So it sounds like for you, a place name isn't just like a dot on the map, which, you know, you kind of flip open the map and you look through and there's, you know, all these sort of standardized place names. It sounds like that's not what it is for the Pueblo of Acoma.
Right. Early on when we were working to understand Mount Taylor, as we were moving, as the Pueblo of Acoma was moving with numerous other Pueblos to respond to impacts on Mount Taylor. And I use that name because Mount Taylor is commonly referred to as such here in the state of New Mexico. We as Indigenous people each have our own name for that mountain. And as different state and federal agencies were coming to understand this special place, and in Acoma we call that particular mountain Kweshtema. And each community has their own name. It is not the same name for that particular place. But as state and federal agencies came forward to understand that particular mountain, what we had to convey to them is that one of the early questions that they had was, where does the mountain begin and where does it end? Is it specifically a dot on the map? Or how do we come to define it? And again, I refer back to these different perspectives and different values that I mentioned earlier, in that naming place for others who came later came from a sense of ownership, of claiming something. And defining those boundaries, specific boundaries of what constituted a mountain. And as we started to talk with traditional Pueblo elders, as we tried to understand the complexity of what this mountain meant to so many communities, I had one elder who explained to the U.S. Forest Service that the mountain, in a sense, was almost as if there was a blanket spread out from the top, that this cover not just the peak of the mountain, which many, many outsiders believe that the mountain was literally just its peak. But they began to understand that from a traditional perspective, it also encompassed the mesas and the valleys and the valley floor, and that that connection began to be as far as the eye could see, which is enormous when you're thinking from a perspective that forces you to define boundaries. And here in the state of New Mexico, where we have the traditional cultural property status that has been given to this particular mountain, Cuestema, as we were working through that effort to designate it, challenged people's perspectives of what defines a mountain. And so when you can open yourself up to the enormity in terms of size of place, then you began to understand those perspectives from indigenous communities when we say that the rivers are associated with the mountain, the valleys are associated with the mountain, that everything that flows outward from the peak or from the valley floor up is also associated with place. And so those connections to those various resources, whatever they may be, then make up the environment that constitutes that mountain. And so for Acoma, because that name Cuestema has the base word in there that reflects our word for snow, it becomes a significant place for Acoma because of its association of a place that does hold that snowpack, which is so vital for our people in terms of resources that sustain our watersheds, our drinking water, the water that is used to feed our fields come spring and allow us to grow corn, the water that is used to help us raise our livestock, water that is used in ceremonial use. And so when you begin to understand the connection that a mountain and its resources give a people, a community, then you begin to understand those positions in which a community takes when it advocates for protecting of its water, of its environment, of its air, of the wildlife, so on and so forth.
So you and I met years ago during the battle over Mount Taylor and trying to protect Mount Taylor, and conversations with you and also with Jim Eno at the Pueblo of Zuni, and both of you helping me understand that there were all these different names for this mountain that I, as an outsider, had only known as Mount Taylor, has really changed my entire perspective. When I look to that mountain, to those mesas, to that landscape now, it has completely changed how I see that landscape and even my place in this landscape. And I was wondering if you have any thoughts on how for outsiders to better understand this indigenous way of seeing the landscape and connecting with the landscape through the past and into the future can maybe benefit these landscapes and all of our connections to them and all of our, abilities to better caretake these places.
There has been a recent use that I have seen, not only here in New Mexico, but across the country, for communities to start using these land acknowledgement statements. And land acknowledgement statements are really meant to acknowledge the land on which we place our feet upon. But I think it has to go beyond a simple recitation of those place names. We really need to connect and do our, to use the words of a colleague, our due diligence. To use our due diligence to do the hard work and the heart work of learning about these places and learning about their history. There are many of us who continue to use our public lands, and especially now in this time when it seems like our public lands are one of the few safe places where we can go out in this pandemic time to safely appreciate the outdoors and be in nature and just connect to the earth, which I think we all need to do. But it has to be more than that. We need to find out about these places and know their stories. And really, that's what it is. Our Pueblo people and many indigenous communities around the world are great storytellers. That's how we keep our history alive, is this oral, strong oral tradition of passing this knowledge on to the next generation, of passing on memory and connection to place. I remember that my father was good at reminding me as we passed place, even if we were out wood hauling or going on some other errand out into the mesas that light below the mountain, he would remind me of these specific name places. And that was not only my internal map to the landscape, but it connected me to these places that perhaps I may have not known about. And it intrigued me to the point where I wanted to ask why. Why is it named that place? Why is this place significant to us as Acoma people? It sparks that inquisitiveness to know more. And I think that's a human trait, is to always want to know more. And in doing so, and in learning more about place, then we broaden our own perspectives. We can understand not only the diversity, but the richness really that surrounds us, so that a place is no longer just simply the forest. It is no longer simply just a mesa or a place that we recreate. We connect to those places. We create our own story, our own memory that is layered upon layer of all the countless stories that came before us. And so in doing so, then we become part of that history. We become part of that story. We become part of place. And so in my work with the National Trust for Historic Preservation, they use a slogan that says, "This place matters." And when we say that this place matters, we can finish that sentence to say, this place matters because of whatever that story is, and however we connect to that story. And so that is why it becomes important to connect beyond just simple land acknowledgement statements, that when we go out into place, that we carry a responsibility to know more, to know about these places that surround us so that we can protect them, so that we can conserve them, and so that we can also give that gift to others and say, you know, there was a great place I hiked, you know, on such and such a day, and this is its story, and I think you should go there. And so we pass those gifts on to other people.
Thank you so much, Teresa. I really appreciate your time, and it's so nice to see you.
It's nice to see you, Laura, and I hope that others will continue to connect to these special places here in New Mexico.